Christmas spirit this morning, yeah? Even as we do a few, the intro, if you'll humor me this morning, but I'm wondering, we talked about a little bit before, but strong names and weak names, powerful names and not so powerful names, mainly for the guys. You know, you'll meet somebody and, you know, I don't know, it's granddad, oh, you know, Daniel, that's a strong name, you know, and you'll hear that from time to time. Ladies, y'all don't have to worry about it. It's usually, oh, that's a beautiful name or it's a pretty name, but you get across names that aren't so powerful. And I hope I don't run into any names this morning, but Harold is, you know, Harold isn't the strongest. I don't know, maybe it's your middle name or something. I'm not sure. Possibly because it's a part of Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to Peace on Earth. Go ahead, sing it. Joy,
nations,
join the of the skies. Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to
the
newborn King. Yeah, brilliant. Well, and the fact that we live in the South is another name that rings out, and I don't know if it's a redneck or hillbilly name, but Chestnut. Chestnut isn't quite the, and it's more than likely because it's chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping. Verse 4, although it's been said. Whoa! Look at Rock Church Choir this morning. And finally, I don't know, the Latino name or whatever, looking at my boy Alex Fanjul, but Feliz. Feliz to me is not very strong name, but Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Contelo dándole felicidad. Yep, nailed it. I want to wish you a
I want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the...
Y'all did so good in that Spanish part. Let's sing it again. Feliz. Feliz Navidad. Alex, you take us there. Feliz Navidad. Get it right, okay?
Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad.
I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom
of my heart.
Yay! Sorry, Latinos, for butchering your language this morning. You gringos don't have a clue what you said. But can I tell you the most powerful name this morning? Come on, the name that is above all names. He's the Alpha and he's the Omega. Come on, he's the beginning and he's the end. He's the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, and they call him Jesus. My title this morning is simply, they call him Jesus. That's it. That's the name above all names. We sang about it this morning. His name is what? They call him Jesus. You see, in the New Testament, it's written in there some 700 to 1300 times, depending on what version you are reading. And what's so beautiful in Matthew, the nativity account of Jesus Christ, that Matthew was more focused on the name of Jesus and the meaning of Jesus more than the actual birth itself. Think about that this morning. He wasn't concerned about how much baby Jesus weighed or how long baby Jesus was or how loud he cried. Come on, he didn't go into the details of which animals were paying attention or the very first time he crawled or anything like that, because he knew as long as you understood the meaning of Jesus, as long as you understood how powerful the name of Jesus is, that's all you would ever need. The name of Jesus. Come on, say it with me one time. Jesus. They call him Jesus. You know, it came from the Hebrew name Yeshua. Yehoshua originally, but Yeshua, which is what? Joshua, which is the one with Moses who led the Israelites into the promised land. But Jesus, the name, come on, from Yeshua. Say Yeshua one time. Yeshua. Way to go. Yeshua. Jesus' name is also referred to, and you've heard it, Yahweh. Someone say Yahweh. Yahweh. Come on, it's the personal name of the fact that it's God of Israel. And I love all these beautiful names. Come on, Emmanuel, the names of Jesus, but it's simply J-E-S-U-S. Even the name Yahweh, they've wondered, you know, exactly what is the meaning of it. And I'll give you four or five of them this morning. It says Yahweh saves. Yahweh is salvation. Yahweh is a saving cry. Yahweh is a cry for saving. Yahweh is a cry for help. And Yahweh is my help. All of those names, every time you say that, all of those meanings, whether it's saves or salvation or a cry for help, it's all wrapped up in the name of Jesus. Do you believe it this morning? Do we serve a beautiful Lord and Savior? What's his name?
Jesus.
Come on, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You see, Yeshua was pretty popular in and around when Jesus was walking the earth, so much so that archaeologists dug up some 71 tombs that were named after Yeshua, rolled away the stone, whatever it was, to just discover the bodies. Can you believe the reason why even the archaeologists would do such a thing? But can I tell you that they went to tomb number 72 that was named. Yo, there's another Yeshua right in here. As they rolled away the stone, guess what they didn't find in there? Jesus. Can you imagine? Yeah, this Yeshua's in. Oh, let's go to the next one. Yeah, he's still here. What about Jesus of Nazareth? No longer there. Precious name of Jesus means the anointed one. Someone say the anointed one. Man, we sang about it this morning. If there's only one word that I could say, it really is. You know, there's some other powerful, you know, words, and you've probably used them. I mean, for me, I'm going to, you know, kind of point out some that the dictionary has, but stop or no is a pretty powerful word. But it's not going to get you too far. Yes is a pretty powerful word. But I'm just wondering, man, how many times that you've been able to just say the name of Jesus and so many things take place. Whether you're celebrating something, Jesus! Yeah. Come on, or heard some bad news, Jesus! Come on, or you just need a promotion in your job, or you need these bills to be paid, or your marriage is such, or you need, to be able to reach out to your children. It's simply what? Jesus. That's why it's so important to have that name in your vocabulary this morning, Christians. You see, the thing is, just as Kenny shared this morning, you don't always have to walk around saying Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You simply have to live like you love Jesus. And then people will come to you. Amen? That's what it was. And so, think the JoJo has a slide of the 10 most powerful words in the dictionary. Are they up there? Yeah. Guarantee. I would say that's a pretty powerful word. Love. Discover. New. proven. What about the word you? It's a pretty powerful word. Save, safety, results, health. What do you think about those words? All pretty important, pretty powerful. As I was looking at those, because I'm just kind of doing a little, man, I wonder what the world thinks powerful words are. It's a shame that Jesus should have been all of them. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Yes? But as I looked at those words, there's not a word in there that doesn't represent Jesus. Think about the fact that the 10 most powerful words, Jesus represents every one of them. Oh, well, Lord, you know, give me a passage. Give me a scripture. So guess what came to mind? John 3:16. Watch all 10 of these words. For God, He's a guarantee. We serve a guarantee God. So loved, God is love. The world that we discovered, that He gave. Come on, all of you going to receive something new on Christmas? That He gave His only begotten Son. Don't you think that proves something? Don't you think that proves the love that God has for you, the guarantee that whosoever, someone say you, believeth in Him. Come on, you have to believe in order to be saved. Should not perish, safety, but have, that's the results, everlasting life. Man, you know, that's the kind of healthy I want to be. Everlasting in heaven kind of healthy. Will you turn with me this morning to John 4? So we continue to talk about the fact that they call Him Jesus. They call Him Jesus. I hope that you call Him Jesus as well. And I want to read a very familiar passage and certainly story in the Bible. We're going to read verses 22 through 26, John 4. We're going to talk about verses 7 through 26. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship. Come on, I hope you knew what you were worshiping this morning, who you were worshiping. For salvation is of the Jews, but the hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and for the Father is seeking such to worship Him. God is the Spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. Verse 25, the woman said to Him, and this is the woman at the well, the Samaritan, which you're going to hear a little bit more about. I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When He comes, He will tell us of all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am He. I who speak to you am He. This morning, I don't want to read the entire passage. Just wanted to read that part and focus on that towards the end. But I want to walk you through this passage, this scripture this morning, this story of the Samaritan woman and this man called Jesus. You see, in verse 7, the Samaritan woman approaches Jesus, and Jesus says what? Give me a drink. Number one, this morning, Jesus teaches us that it is better to give than to receive. You know, Jesus was saying, give me a drink. And you're like, well, you know, He wasn't talking about receiving. He actually asked the Samaritan woman for something. Give me something to drink. But you know, Jesus was just leading to something. Can I hear an amen? He was just leading her, come on, down the path. We just got to open up our mouth in order to reach people for Jesus. Give me a drink. He knew that this question this statement would lead to her having everlasting life. Come on, you never know what your words are going to do for someone. Think about the day that people told you those words and you received Jesus into your heart. Whatever those words might have been, right? It's better to give than to receive, because the thing is, if you don't give your heart to Jesus Christ, you can never receive everlasting life. You can never receive the forgiveness of sins this morning. Amen? So that's what He was teaching. Give me a drink. It's what he teaches us. Verse 9, if you can just follow, fine. Follow down. She said, Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. You see, she was wondering why Jesus was even talking to her. Number 2, Jesus teaches us to love anyone and everyone. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Even those aunts and uncles. Maybe that long-lost brother, the black sheep of the family that you're going to see this weekend. Guess what? You're to love him too. Why don't I hear a bunch of amens on that? Come on, you're to love them too. You see, the issue was, in the Old Testament, where Israel broke off, 10 tribes went to northern Israel and 2 tribes went to Judah. And that's where it started, right there, where the Samaritans and the Jews had issues way back when. And it's even said that most of the Jews would travel around Samaria because they didn't want any parts of the Samaritans. Even though it was the direct part to get the direct way, the most quickest way, come on, GPS guys, quickest way to get to Jerusalem. And that's why Jesus and his disciples were there. So when it came to the well, the Samaritan woman was never expecting Jesus to even talk to him. Talk to her. Never expecting that. You see, there's people out there that are hurting. Maybe that have addictions. Come on, people that are homeless. Maybe the poor. Whatever it is, people that have attitudes. Guess what? They need your love. They need you to love them. We do at Rock Church. We try to create an environment where we're not judging. Come on, judge not lest you be judged. Because as soon as you turn your nose up to them, Jesus is turning his nose up to you. You believe that this morning? Even though she knew, what is this guy even talking to me for? People are wondering why we're doing these invitations, these prayers, these one act of kindness. What am I worthy of this for? Because Jesus loves you and so do I. Verse 10, Jesus said, if you knew who it is who says to you, give me a drink. She had no clue who she was talking to. She had no understanding that it was Jesus Christ. Jesus teaches us, number 3, Jesus teaches us to know who he is and what he sounds like. You see, in verse 25, it says, she says, I know that the Christ is coming and he will tell all things. And here, Jesus was right in front of her. Simply, Jesus said, if you knew who it was you were talking to, ladies and gentlemen, you got to understand who you're talking to. I want you to talk to Jesus more than you talk to your children. I want you to talk to Jesus more than you talk to your spouse. I know some of you are like, well, I talk to Jesus more than I talk to my boss. Well, good for you. But I need you to talk to Jesus more than you talk to anybody else. Can I hear an amen this morning? Not only do you got to know his voice, but he has to know your voice. And also, we got to be listening to the voice of Jesus. Can you imagine? She's heard of this Savior, this Messiah, and he's sitting right here. And she doesn't know his name, doesn't know his voice. Verses 11 through 15, she says, you have nothing to draw with. Here Jesus is like, give me a drink. You don't have anything to draw with. You see, because it's not about the water. Come on, it's about the living water. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Whoever drinks of this water will never thirst again. Anybody drink of that living water? Yes. Of course, she's like, whoa, tell me about this water. You're telling me I don't ever have to come? If I have this water, tell me about this water. You see, she simply realizing, as Jesus was talking to her, that all you need is Jesus. Guys, that's all you need. It's all you need. This Christmas holiday. Yeah. But January 1st, you need Jesus. Come on. January 31st, guess what? You need Jesus. April 15th, when taxes are due, you need what? They call him Jesus. Verses 16 through 18. Jesus tells her, go get your husband. She says, I have no husband. You guys know the account. If you don't, I encourage you to read it this week. I have no husband. And he's like, yeah, you're right. You've had five husbands. Okay. How does this guy know me? You've had five husbands. And yes, the one you're with now isn't even your husband, if you can pick up on that. No, if I ever gave you number four, let's jump back. Jesus teaches us of the living water that leads to everlasting life. You understand that, right? She says, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. And so it leads Jesus to be able to start prophesying a little bit to her. Five husbands. Of course, now what? Before she was surprised that Jesus was even talking to her, and now she doesn't want Jesus to talk to him anymore. She doesn't want to hear from Jesus anymore. Man, he knows. I've had five husbands. How does he know? How does he know that? Now I'm ashamed, and now I'm not worthy of this living water that he talks about. Number five, Jesus teaches us that he knows all of our sins, and no matter the issues, he still offers us everlasting life. That's how she felt, no longer worthy to even serve this man. Ashamed for all that she's done, ashamed that he knew. But can I tell you that just as Danny Saavedra's video said, you can't do anything about the past, but you can do everything about the future. Don't you understand this morning that regardless of what you were or what you did, Jesus loves you today more than ever before. And you need to love him the same. He doesn't care about your past. Come on. This lady's had five husbands. Jesus knew that. And he still was offering everlasting life. There was a time in your life where you may have felt like you weren't worthy. Guess what? You're worthy. They call him Jesus. Finishing up is verse 19 to 24. Can you imagine as this conversation continues to take place. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want you to talk to Jesus. It doesn't every day that you wake up and take your first breath, he's right there waiting on you. Every day he's asking you to take of the living water so you can never thirst again. Every day he's there to be able to forgive your sins of yesterday. Every day he's there just wanting you to draw closer and closer to him. And that's as this conversation goes. First she was shocked that she talked to a Samaritan, and then she's leaning in because of the living water, and then she's ashamed because of the five husbands. But now all of a sudden, she's telling Jesus where her fathers worship. Well, our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but Jews say Jerusalem. The deal was that the Samaritans didn't even feel like they could go to Jerusalem to worship, so they created places to worship God there. But Jesus told her, come on. The hour is coming, and now is. The true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. Last one, Jesus teaches us that it's not about how our descendants worshiped or where they worshiped, but now is the time to worship him in spirit and truth. I can't tell you enough how incredible it is to worship at Rock Church Franklin. Yeah. Every Sunday I find myself looking around and seeing and, you know, can't wait for the new gym because, you know, it's a little crowded, got people down the aisles and, you know, we'll have plenty of room to dance and move around or what have you. And every once in a while I'm just checking on Dallas and Benny and making sure that, you know, that they're doing what they're supposed to do. They're worshiping, but as I'm doing that, I'm just looking around and seeing people worship. I feel like we have a church that worships in spirit and in truth. Because we continue to want the Holy Spirit. Amen? So the Father was, Lord Jesus Christ was able to tell this Samaritan, doesn't matter where you worship. Just worship Him in spirit and truth. Guys, you don't have to be up front. You don't have to be in the back on a Sunday morning to worship the great I am. I'm asking you to worship Him in your car. I'm asking you to worship Him around your house. I'm asking you to worship Him. You're going to need it during, you know, especially you guys are going to wait till December 21st, the 24th, the shop. You're going to need to worship. When the shelves are empty, and there's five people that waited just like you wanting the last one. It is well with my soul. Get off now. It's a place where we worship no matter where. And every time you do it, you draw closer to God than you were before. Every time you say the name of Jesus, you just inch a little closer. Don't you understand that? That's why He was given on this earth in the first place. So that every day we could inch a little closer and closer to Jesus. And yeah, it's certainly days where you take an inch back. Or a week where you take a step back. But it doesn't matter as much as you back up. Every time that you worship and every time that you say the name of Jesus, you're taking a step closer to the King. Come on, you're taking a step closer to the Lord of Lords. Every time. I've never been able to say the word Jesus and not feel something. I've never come into a place of worship. Or last night when we were in the night of worship, in night of prayer, I've never left a place where we've called on God that I wasn't better. Doesn't happen. You can't say Jesus and take a step back. Doesn't work like that. It's simply Jesus. Jesus. So really every day we're taking steps toward the one, they call Him Jesus. Verse 25 and 26, she says, I know that the Christ is coming. When He comes, He will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am He. Imagine in that moment. The fact of simply looking at Jesus when He walked this earth face to face, don't you understand that she had to have felt the presence? There's no way that she didn't, as soon as He came up, there's no way that she didn't feel the atmosphere change. It's impossible. But for whatever reason, because of all the hurt in her life, all the husbands that she had, for whatever reason, she was unable to see Jesus for who He was until He told her, I of whom you speak am He. Imagine the shift in her heart. Imagine the shift in her emotions. Imagine that everything that Jesus was just sharing to her about, the living water, the forgiveness of sins, the fact that she was able to talk to the Messiah face to face. Imagine that moment. as she surrendered her all to the Lord Jesus. As her whole life and her whole atmosphere changed. That everything she ever did. Imagine what it would take to be divorced once, twice, three times, four times. Imagine how many arguments. Imagine how much sin, how much issues that were in that. And yet, she was able to see Jesus face to face and receive of that living water. So much so that she went back and told the people in her village and told everybody about that she knew. And it says many received Jesus. And then it said many more believed because they came. She not only told them about Jesus, but she said, come see this Jesus. You see, we're going to go out this week and we're going to tell people about Jesus. But we're also going to say, guess what? Christmas Day from 11 to 12, come see Jesus at the Rock Church of Franklin. Come see Jesus, the one that we're talking about. Even to invite someone to receive Jesus sometime this week. Guys, it's about understanding who Jesus is in your life. Do you believe it this morning? He loves you so much. And it's all you'll ever need. We're going to celebrate his birthday this Sunday. But we got to celebrate his name every day. It's Jesus. They call him Jesus. Aren't you glad that you know and can hear the voice of the Savior of this world? Can you stand with me this morning? I'm wondering if maybe, love, can you just play a little something on the piano this morning? I want to give you an opportunity to give your life to Jesus this morning or rededicate your life to Jesus today. Haven't asked in a while, but Jesus might be drawing you afresh to him. Maybe you're really struggling. Maybe you're in some of the worst moments of your life. Maybe you've never received Jesus. Maybe you've always kind of talked with him. You understand who he was. But you've never really truly committed your heart to him. I want to give you that opportunity this morning. So can you just bow your heads and close your eyes? Man, he loves us so much. This isn't just another Sunday. This is the day that you live in. It's not yesterday, nor is it tomorrow. But it's about where Jesus is with you right at this very moment. So with nobody looking around except myself, if that's you, if you're saying, I want to give my heart to Jesus, I want you to slip your hand up. Or if you say this morning, man, I just haven't been living for Jesus like I should, I want you to slip your hand up. Recommit your life to Jesus. Is there anyone here this morning? See those hands this morning. I praise God for it. Anybody else? I see that hand as well. I see that hand. Praise God. Four or five people. Yes, I see that hand. You know, it's moments like this where the heavens begin to rejoice. Come on, you don't think heaven is paying attention to what's taking place at 130 Lakeview Road? You don't think the Father's rejoicing as those hands that are lifted are calling on his name? Being saved, receiving Jesus. Come on, as you continue to have your heads bowed and eyes closed, is there anybody else? You've just been contemplating it a little bit. You want to receive Jesus. You want to rededicate your life. I see that hand. Praise God for that hand. Anybody else? Come on, the day is your day. Jesus is right beside you offering living water. Praise God. So this is what I want to do. I want us to pray corporately together. Join with those that are giving their heart to Jesus or rededicating their heart to Jesus. So we can do it together. So repeat after me. Say, Dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. And I know that you died on the cross for my sins. Father, please forgive me of all my sins. Jesus, I receive you into my heart. Come live with me today and forevermore. I give you my all. Thank you, Jesus, for giving me your all. I surrender myself to you today, now and forever. God, we're so grateful for your Son, Jesus. Your only begotten Son. And Jesus, we're so grateful that we can commune with you. Father, that every moment that we've ever had, you've always been right beside us, whether we acknowledged you or not. Jesus, you were always there. Father, in those times where we needed you most, but we didn't recognize who you were still there. Times that you've protected us. Times of anguish and times of discouragement. Jesus, you've always been there. And Jesus, now you're there today more than ever before. So God, we want to continue to call on your name. Father, and I praise God for these 6, 7, or 8 people that gave their heart to you afresh today, Father. Lord Jesus, make your presence known in their homes and in their families and in their minds, soul, spirit, and body. Make yourself known. Because today they call you Jesus. They call you Jesus. Father, we all call you Jesus. So help us to go out today understanding the most powerful word ever. Jesus. We give you the glory. Father, we give you the honor. Jesus, we give you the praise. And all the church rejoices and says yes and amen and amen.